Speaker of the morning is Irene Valenzuela from Harvard, and she's going to start sharing screen. At the end of the talk, I'll facilitate questions either by chat, if you'd prefer to type your question by chat, or if you just say, I have a question, I'll call on you to ask questions at the end.
Okay. Thank you very much, Lara. And thank you to the organizers for the opportunity to present my work here. It's a pity we cannot have stream Fino this year in person and see you all your faces, because I really enjoy always to go to stream Fino, but it's fantastic that given the circumstances, at least we can have this virtual meeting. So thank you so much, the organizers, for organizing this. So my talk is going to be about bubbles of nothing and merging the Swampland conjectures. Okay, so one of the things that I find more exciting about the Swampland program that Isabel already introduced yesterday is that it's all these connections that we are recently discovering between the conjectures, which are hinting, I think, to some that all of them could be just different phases, no, of the same underlying quantum gravity principles. And this is very encouraging. So my talk is going to be about these relations as well as new ones. And I'm going to divide the talk in three parts, which are based on these recent works and this one that hopefully will appear this week or next week. So the first part of the talk is going to be about bubbles of nothing, about nothing, and how they are far more common than what we thought in string compactifications, which is based on this work with Iñaki, Miguel, and Kepa. Then I will move to the weak gravity and the distance conjecture and my favorite asymptotic limits in the field space, in which we can in fact merge these conjectures if there is a Gibbs coupling that goes to zero at the limits. And this is work based in collaboration with Naomi, who is also very nicely taking care of the Slack channel. So thank you for that. And finally, very briefly at the end, I will talk a little bit about some connections that appears when we apply these conjectures to strings and membranes in four dimensions. Okay, so let me start with the first part, nothing is certain. So the question that drives our work is whether any non-supersymmetric vacuum has to be unstable, like they always need to decay. And this was conjectured to be the case a few years ago by Uri Bafan, Freivogel, and Klevan. And it was motivated and based mainly on the weak gravity conjecture. However, the decay channel provided by the weak gravity relies on the vacuum to be supported by fluxes. So our goal is try to find out if there is some universal instability that is always there once we break supersymmetry. And at least in string compactification, no? When we have extra dimensions. And for this purpose, we study these bubbles of nothing. So what is a bubble of nothing? A bubble of nothing is a non-perturbative stability in which there is a bubble that pops in and expands at the speed of light. And there is nothing inside. So it describes the instability from the vacuum to nothing, as the name says. So it was first constructed by Witten many years ago as an instability of the Kaluza-Klein vacuum of a circle compactification. So this is the instanton solution, which is smooth and fine for R bigger than capital R. And if one studies the endpoint of this decay by rotating to the Euclidean, to the Lorentzian, and changing the coordinates, this looks like Minkowski, right? But actually has a hole. Because this metric is only defined for R bigger than R, which means that the space-time ends at capital R, and there is nothing inside. Still, this solution is regular, smooth, and is geodesically complete, because if one studies the size of the extra circle, it shrinks to zero at the bubble wall. Okay. So we have this, I mean, the Euclidean solution is this three sphere, and then we have this circle, this extra S1, which even if it has a finite radius at infinity, at spatial infinity, when we are approaching the bubble wall, it shrinks to zero size. So the topology of this Euclidean solution is S cube times a disk, okay, which is this sigma. And one can compute the the decay rate, and is given by the Euclidean axiom, which depends on the radius. Okay, so this is an instability when we have a circle compactification. So are we worried about it? What does it mean? It means we always have these instabilities. And the point is that we can have a topological obstruction for this bubble to exist. So if we have fermions in our theory, we know that when rotating to pi, the fermions pick a minus sign, which means that the fermions will only be well-defined in the disk if they have antiperiodic boundary conditions, so that we can shrink the circle to zero. Which means that the bubble is not going to exist if the fermions have periodic supersymmetric boundary conditions, at least for this Witten example. Okay, then the lesson that you might get from this is that we don't need to worry, because at least if the theory is supersymmetric, no, at some energy, so it's consistent with periodic boundary conditions that preserve supersymmetry, even if the vacuum then breaks supersymmetry, this bubble is not going to exist. So who cares? Okay, so the message of this part of my talk is that this lesson is wrong. Okay? And this is what we explain in the paper, and we construct an explicit example which has periodic supersymmetry boundary conditions. Okay, so let me explain why, how this works. So first of all, we don't need to restrict to a circle. I mean, we can just talk about any compact manifold. So pick your favorite compactification. The question whether the bubble of nothing exists is a question of whether this compact manifold can be shrink to a point. Okay? And whether this can be shrink to a point is a question of whether this compact manifold can be written as the boundary of a higher dimensional manifold. Because the fact that this works on the circle is because we can fill the circle, right, and have a disk. And then this means that the circle is the boundary of this disk and therefore can be shrink to zero. More general, the same has to happen for other compact manifolds. And if we have fermions, then the spin structure of C has to extend to B. Okay, so the question is whether your given favorite compact manifold can be written as the boundary of another thing. And this is something that has been classified by mathematicians, by the Bordings group. So I don't have much time to explain, but it's just basically it's just an equivalence relation between manifolds such that they are bordant if they are the boundary of the same of another manifold. And precisely, if the manifold C belongs to the trivial class in this Bordings group, it means that it's a boundary of B, so that it's sort of bordant to the point. So whether the bubble of nothing exists is just a matter, at least topologically, of whether the compact manifold belongs to the trivial class on this Bordings group. Okay, so let's use this to see what we learn. If we go to one dimensions, as we did with the circle, omega 1 spin is C2, which means that we have two classes, the non-trivial class and the trivial class, which are precisely the circle with periodic and antiperiodic boundary conditions. And that's why only the trivial class, which has antiperiodic boundary conditions, admits the bubble of nothing. We can go to two dimensions, and the result is the same. Omega 2 is C2, so we can have the two classes. We can go to three dimensions, and this is an example in which the physics induction sometimes fails, because omega 3 is zero. Which means that any three-dimensional spin manifold admits a bubble of nothing, even if it has supersymmetry preserving boundary conditions, which is, I mean, it's amazing. And not only that, I mean, we can go to higher dimensions, and in 4 is again non-zero, but in 5, 6, and 7 is zero. So this applies also to M-theory and G2 manifolds, any 10-dimensional string theory compactifications to 4 dimensions, or any Calabi-Yau ADS compactification, 5 manifolds, and so on. Okay? As long as we only have a spin structure. Okay, so even more, here I'm only talking about a spin structure, but if we have charged fermions, fluxes, and so on, then we have to change this. So for charged fermions, we would need to add here some spin C structure, probably. And there has been a recent conjecture by Jek and Kumrun saying, in fact, that the co-bordism group of any quantum gravity theory should be zero, should be trivial, in order to avoid the presence of global symmetries, okay? Because otherwise these non-trivial classes could be understood as conserved global charges. So that means that, I mean, your given compactification should have all the ingredients that you would need in order to guarantee triviality of these water singles. And a consequence of this is that then there is no topological obstruction to construct bubbles of nothing in quantum gravity. Like, bubbles of nothing would always be allowed if the conjecture is true. Now, for our work, we just focus on omega-3 spin, which is zero, okay? Because we don't need to add new UV ingredients, and this allows us to construct the explicit solution in supergravity, and so that's, that is smooth, so we can trust the semi-classical approximation. But I wanted to point that, I mean, this can be more general and will be valid whenever your manifold belongs to the trivial class in this vortices. Okay, so what is going on? I mean, if there is no topological obstruction, it means that any vacuum always decays, or, for example, if I focus on omega-3, does it mean that any three-dimensional spin manifold, including T-cube with supersymmetric boundary conditions, will always decay? This should bother you, because SUSY vacua should not decay, right? I mean, we know that. So what is protecting supersymmetric vacua from decaying? How do we distinguish if the vacuum is supersymmetric or not? And the answer is energetics, right? I mean, even if it's topologically allowed, when we try to construct a solution to the Einstein equations, it could be that the solution only exists for a radius which is infinite, which means that the decay rate would be zero. This is the Coleman-Deluccia suppression, which acts as a dynamical obstruction. But it's cool because it means that whenever we break supersymmetry, this might generate some finite value of the radius and then a finite decay rate. Okay, is that true? So in general, whether it's energetically favorable to decay is going to depend on whether we have another solution, another asymptotically flat solution different from the vacuum that also has zero energy. Right, zero ADM mass, because we need to decay from the vacuum that has zero energy. And whether this solution exists is constrained by the positive energy theorem of Witten. Okay, so Witten already in this theorem show that manifolds of this type always have some positive ADM mass if these two conditions are satisfied. If they are covariantly constant spinors, and the dominant energy condition is satisfied, which is this condition on the energy tensor, energy momentum tensor. Okay, so if we are trying to construct a bubble for T cube with supersymmetric boundary conditions for T3, then we have covariantly constant spinors because we have boundary conditions that preserve supersymmetry. So in order to construct a bubble of nothing when we break supersymmetry in the vacuum, we need to violate this dominant energy condition. And this is something that generically happens once we break supersymmetry by quantum effects, Gaussian energies, and higher derivative terms. So what we do is to construct an explicit example which violates this condition and has a bubble. So I don't have time to explain this. So just to say that we construct this new type of bubble of nothing, and we violate the dominant energy condition and break supersymmetry by introducing a Gauss-Bonnet term, which in fact this Lagrangian can be, we saw that can arise as a truncation of heterotic string theory and also from type 2B. And yeah, long story short, we solve the Einstein equations, which takes a lot of work. There are many layers and many things to take care of, so the solution is smooth. And in the end, we compute the decay rate, the radius of the bubble and the axiom, which, as you can see, in fact, they diverge, they go to infinity, when alpha, so is going to zero, so when the Gauss-Bonnet term disappears and we satisfy again the dominant energy condition. Okay, so the recipe, so what is exciting about this is that, I mean, this is just the beginning, I think. Like, there are many more bubbles that can be constructed, there are many more cases that one can study, and the recipe goes as follows. So given your compact manifold, you have to study first if it's trivial in vortices group. If not, then okay, there is no bubble of nothing. If it's trivial, then you have to ask whether it admits some covariantly constant spinor. If not, then there is already a bowl of nothing. If it does, so it has supersymmetric boundary conditions, then you have to check if the theory, if the matter content satisfies the dominant the energy condition relevant. And if it violates this, then you have again a bubble of nothing. So this is what I call the topological obstruction, and this is what we call, no, the dynamical obstruction. So the energy condition that needs to be violated for the case of a spin structure is just the dominant energy condition. But this can be, I mean, this has to be generalized if we include fluxes. This is something that we also do in the paper. And for example, if we include fluxes, then the field strength also appears in this energy condition, and then it takes a flavor as the weak gravity conjecture. And in fact, these conditions have been shown, I mean, to correspond to BPS conditions, and also has been used to show that the black holes have a mass bigger than the charge. So it's something we want to study more in the future, but it really looks as if by satisfying the weak gravity conjecture, then we are going to violate this, and then we are going to have the bubbles of nothing. And this is very interesting because in the same way that this topological obstruction, no, the fact that the Bordesian group has to be trivial, has been conjectured to be general in quantum gravity by the connection to global symmetries, it could be, and that's the next thing we have to study, that these energy conditions that you need to violate to avoid this dynamical obstruction are also now connected to the weak gravity and other Swampland conjectures, which talk about the dynamics, right, and quantify how close you can get to the situation of recovering a global symmetry. And if they are always violated, it would mean that this bubble of nothing would always be a universal instability, one supersymmetry is broken. Okay, so this is the first part of my talk. And now let me switch to the second part, which is about the weak gravity and the distance conjecture, and my favorite asymptotic limits in the modular space. Okay, so why I think this going to these limits in modular space is interesting is because it's precisely in these limits where quantum gravitational effects and these Swampland conjectures have a bigger impact in the infrared. Because here we are trying to engineer approximate global symmetries, weakly coupled gauge theories, large field ranges. And the lesson is that even if all these things seem fine from the point of view of quantum field theory, they come at a price. I mean, when you are trying to reach the limit, you are trying to restore a global symmetry. So the effective field theory has to break down. And the cutoff has to go to zero. And how exactly it breaks down is then quantified by these Swampland conjectures. No? Because you have this infinite tower of states and also these runaway potentials. So in the past few years, we've been using these techniques of asymptotic Hodge theory to study the physics at the asymptotic limits in a model independent way. And it's nice that also in this last paper of Cecotti, he also remarked these mixed Hodge structures as the mathematical structure that distinguishes n equals 2 theories that are consistent with quantum gravity from general ones. So I just want to say a little thing, just a comment, which is that I feel that sometimes we have not done our best explaining what we mean with asymptotic, and this has led sometimes to the misconception of the scope of our work. So I just want to point out that here with asymptotic, I just mean that there is some scalar, no, that takes large values, so you are approaching, no, some limit in the modular space. But I don't mean that one has to reach the boundary or even be parametrically close to it. It just means that this asymptotic limit is the regime at which there is a perturbative expansion that makes sense. So that this parameter 1 over s is small. I mean, that there is an expansion. And now, depending what is the answer that you want to get, I mean, what is the question, you can keep more terms on this expansion or less terms. Okay? But asymptotic just means that there is a perturbative expansion in some parameter. So one of the interesting questions that we've been checking is, well, to identify what are these infinite tower of states that are becoming light when the field distance becomes large. And one of the most important questions here, I think, is what is exactly this value of lambda, right? This exponential rate. Because it's not specified by the conjecture. And the exact value actually has implications. I mean, it's very important if we want to give phenomenological implications. So let me tell you what is the information that we have obtained for this value of lambda from our analysis of this n equals 2 moduli spaces, okay, these Calabi-Yau compactifications. And what we learn is that lambda is related to the properties of a discrete infinite symmetry that is generating the tower of PP states and is bounded by this value. So this is a result that already appeared in my first paper with Thomas and Aaron for the case of one field. And we have only very recently generalized to multiple field with now in this paper. So it's much more difficult to do it with multiple fields because then you have to project along the geodesics and it's not always the same tower that satisfies this bound, but still we can find the bound and it's given in terms of this integrity, which is indeed associated to this discrete symmetry. And it characterizes the type of asymptotic limit that we are approaching. So for the case of a Calabi-Yau threefold compactification, I mean, this D is bounded by the internal dimension of the space. So for a Calabi-Yau, then it can be 1, 2, or 3. Okay. And that's why the minimum value that can ever take is 1/√6. Okay, because Calabi-Yau has a complex dimension 3. So you can ask whether there is any meaning for this particular numerical value. And this is what I'm going to explain now. So we gave in this last paper with Naomi, we gave a meaning in terms of the weak gravity conjecture. Because if there is a Gibbs coupling that is vanishing at the infinite distance limit that occurs in these moduli spaces, the exponential rates can be in fact determined in terms of the extremality bound of the black holes, because the same tower that satisfies the distance conjecture also satisfies the weak gravity conjecture. I want to point out that there is also, it was also remarked some connection to the TCC, because in four dimensions, up to some modification done in this paper, this TCC prediction is exactly also 1/√6. But I think this is a coincidence that only happens in four dimensions as far as I can see, because our bound depends on the internal dimensions and not on the space-time dimension. Okay, so let me show you what is the relation that we find with the weak gravity conjecture. So for that, we need to understand the weak gravity conjecture in the presence of scalar fields. The problem is that there are two ways to understand the weak gravity then, because without scalar fields, the weak gravity is both an extremality bound, a super extremality bound, and a repulsive force condition, no? That gravity has to be weaker than the gauge force. But in the presence of scalars, these two conditions become different. However, as was very nicely studied in this paper of Lee, Lerch, and Weigand, they seem to coincide at the weak coupling limits, in the sense that if the tower is solely charged under a single gauge field that has this gauge kinetic function, then the extremality bound takes this form. And then if this tower satisfies the distance conjecture, the exponential rate of the tower becomes equal to this exponential rate of the gauge kinetic function. So what we do is to study this in generality for any asymptotic limit and any number of fields, also of gauge fields. So this is not true anymore. I mean, it's more complicated than this function, but still it seems to work. So in order to do that, we need to study both the structure of VP states in n=2 and also the attractor flow equations, no, to get the extremality bound of the black holes. So regarding the structure of the VP states, it always forms a degenerate ellipsoid. The charge to mass ratio is always a degenerate ellipsoid, which is cut by the charge restrictions to get VP states. And we provide a recipe to compute the principal radius of this ellipse for any number of moduli, any number of gauge fields, in terms of what we call some single charge states, which can be determined at any asymptotic limit of the moduli space. So because it depends on the discrete data associated to the singular limit. So we find that these BP states indeed are extremal at these asymptotic limits, which are like weak coupling limits, right? There is always some perturbative expansion. And the exponential rate of the mass is related to the exponential rate of the Gates kinetic function, which means that the the exponential rate of the distance conjecture is fixed by the extremity bound, and this is how we got the bound that I showed you before. Okay, so we also study the extremality bound along non-BPS directions, where the BPS state seems to be enough to satisfy the weak gravity convex hull condition, but let me skip this and just give you the take-home message of this part, which is that at every infinite field distance limit with that there is a Gates coupling going to zero, we find that there is an infinite tower of states that is both extremal and satisfies this no-force condition. And then the distance conjecture is just a tower with gravity conjecture. And the lambda, the exponential mass rate, is fixed by the extremality bound. So there are no more order one unknown factors in the conjecture. Whether this can apply to any infinite field distance limit depends on whether there is a Gates coupling going to zero, always. So that's the question, whether we always have a vanishing Gates coupling. And I think this, for this to be true, we need to extend the analysis, not just to particles and Gates fields, but to any P-form, I mean, to more general P-form Gates couplings. And then it becomes very similar to the string emergence conjecture of Lillerch and Weigand, where they say that not only one can have decompactification limits, but also limits in which the tower is given by excitation modes of a perturbative string. Okay, so this brings me to the last part, which will just take me 5 minutes, which is what happens if we now think of these extended objects, not the strings and membranes, and what are the, there are some nice relations that appear between the Swampland conjecture there. Okay, so not just the distance conjecture, but also the weak gravity. We know that it applies to not just to particles, but to P-form Gates fields in general, right? So it also talks about strings and membranes. And this is interesting because these two cases, I mean, are interesting because the two-form and three-form Gates fields, in fact, parameterize the axionic kinetic terms and the scalar potentials of the EFT. So constraints on the kinetic terms and potentials can be translated to properties of the strings and membranes. And as I will show you, applying the weak gravity for strings and membranes in particular imply the distance and the Sitter conjecture in certain limits. Okay, so how this works? Well, if you have just a general four-dimensional n equals one effective field theory, if there are approximate shift symmetries, so you have axions in your theory, you can dualize these axions to two-form Gates fields, and then the field metric is parameterized by the two-form Gates couplings. Okay? And this is something that occurs when we are near these asymptotic limits. Also, if you have fluxes, so if the potential is induced by fluxes in your compactification, so at the perturbative level, we can dualize these fluxes to three-form Gates fields, and then the scalar potential is parameterized by the three-form Gates couplings. Okay, so this is just a dualization, but we can now add BPS charge objects, okay? So fundamental strings and membranes, and the tension and the charge of these objects, how they depend on the scalars, is completely fixed by supersymmetry. So we find that these objects always satisfy these identities of cell, which means that this does not depend on the vacuum, and they in fact look as a no-force condition. So each contribution can be understood from exchanging scalars, gravitons, and Gates fields. So when p is equals one, like the string, this one goes to zero, and for p equals two, this is the -3/2 that appears here. However, the interpretation is a bit tricky because we are talking about very low dimension objects, which induce a very strong back reaction, which is changing the asymptotic structure of the vacuum. So how do we even talk about the tension and the charge of this object, right? And the point is that we should not think of these objects as states of a vacuum, but rather as localized operators entering the EFT. And then we can just study the low energy dynamics of the EFT, of the full EFT. So the following Polchinski, right, the brain coupling should be regarded as defined at the EFT cutoff, lambda. And then the classical back reaction induced by the objects can be understood as a classical RG flow that makes the tension of these objects scale dependent already at the classical level. So if these brain couplings, I mean, these are relevant, are marginally relevant for the case of the string and relevant for the case of the membrane. Okay, so very quickly, for the strings, we can study the RG flow. And this classical back reaction takes this form for the suctions, these are the scalars, and E is the charge of the string, and R is the distance from the string. Okay. So in these asymptotic limits, this implies that the tension becomes scale dependent on this form, which means that when we approach the string, when we go to the core of the string, which is like going to the UV, okay, to high energies, then the suctions, the scalars, are sent to infinity, and the tension is sent to zero. So by approaching these strings, we are proving large field variations of the scalars. And what asymptotic limit we are approaching, what infinite distance limit, depends on what is the charge of the string. So what we study and we propose is that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the EFT lattice of these weakly coupled strings and the infinite field distance limit that you can have in these n equals one compactification. And this is nice because, for example, if we now compute the field range, the distance, this is just given by the integral of the charge of the string. And if we impose that this string satisfies the weak gravity conjecture, then the field distance becomes equal to the log of the tension. Or in other words, the tension decreases exponentially with the field distance. But this tension is just a cutoff of the effective field theory, right? So what we are recovering is just the distance conjecture, in which now the exponential rate, this factor, is indeed given by the extremality bound. And we have only used the weak gravity conjecture here. Okay, so just the last slide. We can do the same for membranes. There is a classical back reaction, which makes the theory go very quickly to a strong coupling origin. And we can identify membranes, I mean, try to study what membranes satisfy the weak gravity conjecture, which is going to depend on the Keller potential. So if we restrict to these asymptotic limits, we can identify some streamer membranes. And this formula is very similar to what happens in the case of the particles in n equals 2. So this is determined by the exponential rate of the free-form gauge coupling. And one can show that the charge of the membrane satisfies this, which means that if the scalar potential is fully given, fully parametrized by these membranes, which is not necessarily the case, but if it is, then this contribution to the scalar potential automatically satisfies the de Sitter conjecture with a factor that depends on this extremality bound. And this is very similar, as I said, to what happens with n equals 2 with particles, in which the exponential rate of the tower was fixed by this exponential rate of the one-form gauge couplings instead of the three-form gauge couplings. However, these alphas are given by the discrete data of the asymptotic limit, so are given by the same type of discrete data. And that's why we always get the same type of numbers. So I think this also provides some geometric understanding of why these factors that appears in the distance conjecture are the same that appears in the runaway of the scalar potentials. Okay, so let me summarize. So bubbles, nothing are far more common than we thought. The distance conjecture tower can be understood also as a weak gravity tower, which fixes the exponential rate of the tower in terms of black hole extremity bound in n equals 2. And if we go to n equals 1, then we can apply the weak gravity to the string and membranes to understand also the distance conjecture and the de Sitter conjecture. So thank you very much.
All right, questions for Irina? Feel free to type in the chat. Jim first.
Hi, Irene. Really nice talk. I was going to make sure I understood the basic point of the first part of your talk, but your point here on the summary slide already makes it that bubbles of nothing are far more common than thought. And you guys phrased it in a topological language, which is really beautiful. But the existence of the solution is different from whether or not it's cosmologically relevant. How do I think about branch? So I can decay into this bubble of nothing, but it being relevant cosmologically depends on branching ratios. How do I think about that here? Is that something you guys have thought about, or maybe there's
it's true. This is a non-perturbative instability, so it can be very highly suppressed.
Yeah.
So it can be completely fine for our universe, and it depends on the size of the extra dimensions. It would be very interesting now to study this type of bubbles, not just on Minkowski flat space, but like the sitter and areas.
Yeah.
Because I don't know, like for me, as a long-term thing, I would really like to understand if there's any connection between how much we are breaking supersymmetry and the cosmological constant, right? And if this has an effect on the decay rate of these bubbles or not. And that would be very interesting, but yeah, at the moment I don't know.
So relative branching ratios between this, for instance, and Coleman DeLucia decay, there's nothing to say at this point.
Yeah, no, I don't know. That would be interesting to say.
Thank you.
And how they collide, what happens if two bubble of nothing collide, right?
Bubble of extra nothing. All right. Thanks a lot. Nice talk.
Next question is from Ben.
Ben, hi. Thanks. Thanks for the very nice talk, Irene. I really enjoyed it. My question was just about what you said at the very end, which I didn't have time to fully absorb, about a connection to the de Sitter conjecture.
Uh-huh.
I'm wondering if I correctly understood you that what you were talking about was, again, in an asymptotic regime of the moduli space. So then I guess it's related to what was already pointed out about the connection between the distance conjecture and the de Sitter conjecture.
Yeah, it's another way to see the same. So if we are at these asymptotic limits, then the metric takes such a form that we can find these extremal membranes, and then the contribution of these membranes to the scalar potential satisfies automatically the de Sitter conjecture. It's nice that it could be related, from the idea of emergence, right? Like that, since we are at these asymptotic limits, these runaway potentials can be understood as emerging from integrating out the towers of the distance conjecture. Maybe that's why there is also these relations that appear.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
Yeah. But it's only at the asymptotic limits, yes.
All right, I was muted. Time for one more, Hiroshi.
Yes, so I have a question about your first part of your talk. So you had this nice flow chart with yes, no questions. So regarding the dynamical criteria, have you shown that these criteria are both sufficient and necessary, like for example, fermion boundary condition, you said yes or no, and if it is no, then it automatically implies that the vacuum is unstable, the flowchart shows that. Did you show that it's actually sufficient?
No, so we know that because of the positive energy theorem, that if you satisfy this dominant energy condition and have covariantly constant spinners, these are sufficient conditions to have a positive alien mass.
Right, so that means that even if these are not satisfied, it's not sufficient to have the vacuum to be
exactly. So it's so we have not exactly. What would be interesting is the other direction, right? What happens now if it's sufficient not to violate one of them to have the
yeah. So I think it's important to understand what are exactly the conditions that implies automatically that
I completely agree. I mean, I tend to think that they are enough, but the way we approach was just to construct an example and see, like, okay, in this example, we were violating these conditions and it indeed was enough to construct the bubble of nothing and everything worked. But it would be nice to have a more general understanding of this.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a couple more questions, but we're running a little bit low on time. So I'm gonna do one more, David, and then we'll have to break at that stage.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks, Irene, for the talk. I just had one question on the last slides with the relation to the Sitter conjecture. So actually, do you, given in principle, you know the charges for all these objects, do you actually get a number for this C and lambda, and does it match the bound that we proposed indeed?
So all these values are given by the discrete data that is associated to a singular limit. So it can be determined the same way that we do it for the distance conjecture. And this is something that we study in more detail in this paper with Thomas. And it doesn't, so it there is a connection in the sense that since it's given by the same discrete data, sometimes you can find an energy with the same value that we get for the tower of states, but doesn't necessarily give I don't think it necessarily fits the like the TCC bound, like it goes as 1 over D minus 2, D minus 3. And precisely because, for example, if we come from a Calabi-Yau 4-4, then our D, this D, can go to 4, right? So it's going to be much, it was going to be smaller than that.
Ah, that's the same D as, okay, I see. Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Sorry to cap the questions at this stage. Feel free to message the speaker afterwards. Thank you very much, Irina. Let's all thank her one more time.
Thank you. And,